Good evening and welcome to the Gerald R. Ford Presidential Library. My name's Gary Gunderson. I'm the supervisory archivist here at the library. We're very pleased to have you here for our program this evening, and I'm going to let the cat out of the bag. This is going to be really fascinating based on the pre-programmed conversation over dinner. But you didn't hear that from me. Our program this evening is brought to you by the National Archives and Records Administration with financial support from the Gerald R. Ford Presidential Foundation, including Friends of Ford, for which we are very thankful. Now, before we get started, we have a few quick housekeeping chores to take care of. So first of all, please turn off all cell phones and other electronic items. We are video recording our program this evening, so when we get to the question and answer session, please go to the microphone at the back of the auditorium in the center aisle to ask your question. That way we can hear you on the audio for the video, and everyone in the auditorium can hear you as well. And please remember, questions only and no public statements. That way we can answer as many questions as possible. Okay. I'm glad you're open to that. And after the program, our speakers will be signing copies of their books, which we also have for sale outside our auditorium. All right, on with the show. Tonight, I'm very privileged to introduce former Congressman Tom Davis, Republican from Virginia, and Martin Frost, Democrat from Texas, who have a combined 40 years of congressional service and played key roles as their respective party field generals, each serving two terms as chair of the Republican and Democratic House campaign committees. Both Davis and Frost are moderates who watch their party shift to the right and to the left. Their frustration with this widening gap between the parties and its toll on bipartisanship, including the principle of compromise and the art of governing, led them to join forces along with journalist Richard Cohen in authoring The Partisan Divide, Congress in Crisis. In The Partisan Divide, Davis and Frost examine the causes of legislative gridlock and offer a common sense bipartisan plan for making our Congress function effectively again. Gerald Ford would certainly approve of their efforts. Tom Davis served 7 terms in the House of Representatives and authored more than 100 bills that were enacted into law. He is widely recognized as a skilled legislator, an honest broker, and a political mastermind. Congressman Davis is a graduate of Amherst College and the University of Virginia Law School. He currently serves as a director of federal government affairs for Deloitte Consulting. Martin Frost, our other speaker, served 13 terms in the House of Representatives and chaired the House Democratic Caucus for 4 years. He is known as a keen observer of national politics and policy and earned a strong reputation as a strategist and innovative lawmaker with an ability to craft bipartisan legislation. Congressman Frost is a graduate of the University of Missouri and Georgetown University Law Center. He is currently a senior partner in the Washington office of the Polsinelli Law Firm. Now for our program, Tom Davis will speak first, followed by Martin Frost, and we will then conclude with both speakers on stage for the question and answer session. So please join me in welcoming Tom Davis and Martin Frost to the Ford Presidential Library.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Well, thank you very much. Well, thank all of you for spending your evening here. It's a good thing the Tigers aren't in the World Series, just for our purposes. And neither are the Nats, so I'm here as well. The most important part of my biography is the fact that I left Congress undefeated and unindicted, and I'm just very, very... So Martin and I, you know, I'm a partisan Republican, Martin's a partisan Democrat, but we were deal makers. We knew how to work with the other side. We felt when the election was over, it was time for everybody to act like grown-ups again and try to get things done. And we got thrown together on some talk shows, and we started comparing notes afterwards. Now, we were campaign chairman for two successful cycles each for our respective campaign committees, but we never went head-to-head. And so we could still be friends, and we never had that competition. We started comparing notes, and we agreed basically on what ails American politics, and we thought we'd write a book about it. And so what I've got up tonight, I've got some of the charts from the book to try to explain to you in That doesn't mean you shouldn't buy the book and read it, but but it to try to explain to you at least, you know, how things went so bad. How bad is it in Washington? Now, they do have a deal now, but remember, the deal now just funds the government. It's not, you're not getting anything big done. All they're doing is raising the debt ceiling, which you have to do under the law. All they're doing is getting some spending numbers out for the year. There's no, and they're applauding themselves for doing that, but you're not getting a lot of innovation out of government. And even the routine items now are hard to handle. And when the voters look under the hood at how Congress operates, you know, it doesn't look very pretty. How bad is it in Washington? It's so bad that Dan Snyder, who is the owner of the Washington Redskins, opined a couple of weeks ago and admitted that the term Washington Redskins was divisive, it was polarizing, and he was thinking of changing the name from the Washington Redskins to just the Redskins. So this is, what I've got here is a series of charts and maps, and I'm going to go through it. Can everybody hear me okay? Okay. This is a map from a county by county map of the last presidential election. I'll get to that later. Three macro causes have occurred over the last 20 years that have really led to this polarization outside of individuals involved. There are some macro factors that have occurred that have basically taken the middle away from American politics. Let's start with the way districts are drawn today in the House of Representatives, even in the Senate. In the Senate, you have very polarized states now where the Senate election is basically one-party elections. But in the House, fully 80% of these districts are pre-drawn to elect either a Republican or a Democrat. November doesn't matter. It is just a constitutional formality. The race that counts is the primary election. So for members, what does that mean? That means I got to pay attention to people that elect me. That's my primary voters. So I pay my attention, my rhetoric, and my voting record, I hone to my primary voters, who tend to be a pretty thin ideological slice of the electoral pie. Right on the Republican side, left on the Democratic side. Republican conference has never been as conservative as it is now. The Democratic conference never as left as it is now. So both of these are split wide apart, and we're going to talk a little bit more about that. This didn't just happen overnight. Three factors caused this. First of all, residential sorting patterns. People who think alike live alike. It's no surprise that Ann Arbor is a liberal bastion. People who flock here, university communities, there's often a group think of overwhelming Democratic majorities come out of the city. The surrounding county, a little bit more mixed. Cities tend to be overwhelmingly Democratic today. Rural areas, very Republican. But people like to live around people who think like they do. And there's a book called The Big Sort, if you want to get into it, by Bill Bishop, a demographer out of Austin, Texas, where he illustrates this. But you now have huge enclaves of liberals and conservatives living peacefully with each other. Not very mixed. Over time, demographics can change things. But residential sorting patterns are more pronounced today than at any time in history. Secondly, the Voting Rights Act. What does the Voting Rights Act do? It basically says you can't discriminate against minorities when you're drawing districts. So the tendency there is to pack minorities into their districts, which bleaches the districts around them. Result of that, in the Deep South today, in the House of Representatives, In the five Deep South states, all you have are white Republicans and black Democrats. That's it. No need to talk to the other side, by the way, because they play no role in the nomination process. You got to ask yourself, is this really where the country needs to go? Does this bring it together? It's a polarizing factor. Voting Rights Act does a lot of wonderful things, but one of the unintended consequences, it's aided polarization. And then finally, of course, old-fashioned gerrymandering. With the data analytics that are available today, and I'll get into this a little more, these districts are drawn with precision that lasts more than a term or two. They can even anticipate future demographic patterns. Now, if this were the only problem, you could probably get it resolved through the courts or some laws. But there are two other factors, basically, that have exacerbated the problem. One are the media models. When the Federal Communications Commission did away with the equal time or the fairness doctrine, some smart media moguls said, you know what? We don't have to present both sides anymore. Why don't we get a built-in audience of people who are dedicated to our point of view? And up sprang talk radio, up sprang cable news, and this stuff may pretend to be objective, but they're feeding the beast every night as people, the activists element, are tuning in every night and hearing what they want to hear, watching what they want to watch. And these are great business models. News models, not necessarily, but great business and entertainment models. And the worst part, of course, is the growth of the internet, on which there are no filters at all. The internet today, what we call the crap to content ratio coming over the internet, just exceptionally high. You know, I got Barack Obama's birth certificate from Kenya sent to me over the internet, and it looked real. I started to believe it looked pretty real, and then somebody sent me his birth certificate from Indonesia. And so, but this stuff gets forwarded around. People start reading it, believing. I talk to members of Congress, and they go back and talk to their constituents, and their constituents are just they have a different fact set than they do. Congressional Budget Office, Office of Management, that doesn't count. It's this other stuff that's get forwarded. It takes on a life of its own. And in campaigning, the same truth. But there are no filters on the internet. Reading on the internet has, you know, at least in the old days, what we remember, you know, you had NBC, CBS, ABC. There were filters. You may not like the news coming down. It might have been, but it was filtered, and it was generally pretty accurate. Today, that's just not the case. And so that has added to the polarization because the message is no longer down the middle for the most part. Messages tend to be right and left from the way people receive their information. And of course, finally, the money in politics. Money in politics has now moved from the political parties, which have been a centering force in American politics for 200 years, because the parties compete for the middle. And if you nominate a candidate that's out of line, whether it's a Goldwater or McGovern, you come back the next time and readjust. And parties are a centering force. But under McCain-Feingold and campaign finance reform, we took that money away from the parties. We said parties can't spend this evil soft money. Candidates can't spend it. And Martin and I both opposed it. Of course, we were campaign chairmen. And we said, well, where do you think this money's going to go? Do you think this money's just going to disappear? There's what we call the law of unintended consequences. And this money is back, and it is back in force. And it's back in super PACs. It's back in dark money under 501c4s. It's back now where the parties are now starved. And in a lot of these targeted races, you have more money spent by outside groups than you have by the candidates and parties combined. And by the way, when the money doesn't go to the parties, it tends to go left and it tends to go right. And by the way, these groups also play in primaries. Parties don't play in primaries. Because if it's a safe Republican seat and I'm a campaign chairman, I'm not going to waste my money electing the right Republican. First of all, that's controversial within my caucus. And secondly, it's going to be a Republican seat anyway. We're going to have control. I spend my money in those 20% of the seats that are marginal. But these interest groups don't. And they want the right kind of Republican or the right kind of Democrat. And these are enforcement mechanisms. And it has an effect on the way members vote. They don't want to get on the target list of these groups because these groups can drop $1 million on you just like that. And you have to make your money up in small increments under what are called hard dollars. It's had a huge effect on polarizing. So these factors have just emerged in the last 20 years. And so we look at this polarization. It didn't come out of thin air. These are the factors that caused it. This is a congressional district. It's a voting rights district in North Carolina. Only thing it has in common is an African-American majority. It's designed to fulfill the requirements of the Voting Rights Act. This is a congressional district. The third district in Maryland. This is a Democratic gerrymander in Maryland designed just to make sure that the Democrats have a 7-to-1 majority in the Maryland congressional delegation. This is the earmuff district in Chicago. Combines two Hispanic areas connected by a freeway out there in the West. I'm sure that's what the founding fathers had in mind when they looked at their districts. This is another Maryland district. Looks like a squiggle there. You know, if Picasso were alive today, he would not have to go through his blue period for artistic fulfillment. He could be a drawer of congressional districts, get the same level of artistic fulfillment, and probably a lot more money. And, oh, this is my favorite. I could put 70 districts up like this. This is not unique. How do you like that one? That's a Republican gerrymander in Pennsylvania. I like this one because it's like one dog kicking another dog, if you look at it. Designed only to create a Pennsylvania, the Republicans did a masterful job. Democrats got more votes for the House of Representatives in 2012 in Pennsylvania than the Republicans, and the delegation was 12-5 Republican. And nationally, the Democrats got more votes for the House of Representatives in 2012, 1.4 million more votes, but the Republicans have a 17-seat lead. So right now, because of the 2010 elections and the way districting was done, it's advantage Republicans in the House. It doesn't mean the Democrats can't take it, but they need a little bit of a wave to take the House back. It is advantage Republicans. As the macro factors have had the party leaders move, the party bases have moved too. You can see now government regulation of business does more harm than good, almost almost a 40-point difference between the party bases on these and identified problems. By the way, this is a Pew survey of 20,000 voters. Stricter environmental laws and regulations cost too much money and hurt the economy. 35-point margin between the bases of the respective parties. No wonder they can't agree. We also see voting today. It used to be people voted for the person. My mom said, we vote for the man, well, or the woman. But no longer. We used to vote for the name on the back of the jersey, but today we're voting for the color of the jersey. And we're seeing less ticket splitting at this point than at any time in the last 100 years. And to illustrate this, Martin and I decided to put a chart together showing what happened in the last Senate elections. So we took this Democrats in the top that were up for re-election and the Republicans up for re-election at the bottom, and then we took the Obama percentages. And you see where Romney did best, the Democrats fell. They just fell. So you get to Virginia, which, by the way, was an Obama state, but falls in this area as Obama only took it by 3 points. Mark Warner survived in Virginia by just by about a point and a half. A lot of pundits on election night were shocked the race was so close. But those of us who understand that voters are now voting for the party, this is basically voting in a parliamentary way, weren't surprised at all. And then the Republicans went on to take Colorado and Iowa. Remember, this was a huge Republican off-year wave, both 2010 and 2014. So and the Republicans now have an 8-seat margin in the Senate. On the Republicans, they were basically Republican seats up because this was the class from 2008 that was up where you had a big Democratic year the time before. Susan Collins from Maine stands out, but Maine does not have a lot of change. You have a lot of voters there, have lived there forever. You can still personalize politics. It has a strong independent voting history. And the other senator from Maine is an independent who caucuses with the Democrats. But more importantly, Collins is pretty moderate. She gets back to the district every weekend, but she's the exception to the rule. Now, National Journal is a national publication. Each year, or every 2 years, they take a look at the Congress, and they take a look at about 100 votes of how members voted. And they rank the most liberal member and the most conservative member, and they rank all 435 members. I was from a swing district out in Northern Virginia, out in the Washington, D.C. suburbs. Had a Democratic lean to it, but it was a kind of a swing seat. And so I always wanted to be in the middle of the pack. I didn't want to be over on the right. That wouldn't help me in a general. They just tag you on that. But a lot of members fight hard to get over to be the most conservative member of the House or to be the most liberal member. There's a lot of competition to get out there in the wings from the respective parties. So what we did is we took the most liberal Republican in each Congress and the most conservative Democrat, and we said, how many voters are ranked between those two? And let's track this over the last 30 years and see where it goes. So we went back to 1982. There were 344 members that voted between the most liberal Republican, who was Bill Green, who was from Manhattan. You know he had to be liberal just to survive up there. And you had a guy from Georgia at that point who was a member of the Birch Society who was a Democrat. It was a one-party district. By 1994, that number had dropped to 252. By 2002, it had dropped to 137. In the last Congress, it is complete. And by the way, these three members, McIntyre from North Carolina, retired. Matheson from Utah, retired. And Barron from Georgia was defeated, Democrat defeated. So again, there's no room now. These are parliamentary behavior on the part of the parties. The Senate, where the statesmen reside and they're not as partisan, 58 members in 1982, 34 in 1994, down to 7 in 2002, and the last three Congresses, it has been zero. There is no space between the parties. Liberal Republicans are gone, conservative Democrats are gone. Now, they may not talk that way at election time, but this is the way they vote in Washington, and that's the National Journal, which is a very respected nonpartisan publication. This is a chart showing presidential voting patterns by state. We call these the blue wall. These are 18 states plus the District of Columbia, and notice Michigan is among them, that have voted Democrat for president now six straight times, which Martin and I call a trend. Six straight times we put it in a trend. On the Republican side, you have 13 states that have voted Republican six straight times. Now, for the Democrats, if the House is advantaged Republicans, the Electoral College is advantaged Democrats, because this is 242 electoral votes if this holds. You only need 270 to win. Republicans have 102 here. And for Republicans, Ohio and Florida are must states. They cannot afford to lose them. And John Kasich wanted to remind you of that, and Marco Rubio, who are from those two states, their presidential races. But these are important. So Republicans have a narrower path to victory in the presidential race. Democrats have a narrow path in the House. So we have a chapter called the New Normal, where we say divided government, we're going to have to learn to live with divided government. That's kind of the new normal. Illustrate it. Since 1980, 80% of the time we've had divided government. One party's controlled the presidency, and the other party has controlled at least one House of Congress. And there are some swing voters in the middle, and they play a role sometimes when things get too bad. In fact, the last three times one party has controlled the House, Senate, and presidency together, they've been swept out the next time. There's this group of voters in the middle, they just don't participate in primaries, so they get the choices the parties give them. But they know when things aren't going well, and they will come out with a vengeance. So in 1994, Republicans, after 40 years, came in. 2006, 2010, the last three times one party's controlled everything. I always say that my voters in Northern Virginia elected me in 1994 to protect them from Bill Clinton. 2 years later, they reelected Clinton to protect them from me. That there are some people up there that really don't buy into the right and the left. They're in the middle, and when things get too unbalanced, they will go the other way. Now, this is up here. Martin and I put this up here because you say, okay, that's the presidential voting. How do they vote in Senate elections? And the answer is, in Senate elections, these red wall states, 25 senators are Republican, one Democrat. They're not splitting their tickets. The one Democrat is Heidi Heitkamp from North Dakota, who won with less than 1%. Over here, in the blue wall states, it's 32 Democrats, four Republicans. Three of those four Republicans elected in 2010. An off year, the biggest Republican off year since 1938. And they're going to be at risk this next time. So we're seeing pretty much single party voting on the part of the electorate in these races. 2016, the undercard, the presidential race, the big race, but the undercards control the Senate. These are the Republican seats up next time. These are the Democratic seats up. Look at Democratic seats are all up in states Obama carried. Republicans have seven seats up in states that Obama carried last time. They have a four-seat margin, 54 to 46, the way it caucuses right now. They're going to be, the undercard is control of the Senate. And it's clearly going to be on the bubble depending on what the aerodynamics of the presidential race are. Just really quickly to go through this, we have this chart, and we'll get into questions and answers. These green counties are counties that Bill Clinton carried in 1996 that Obama lost, even though Obama performed better. These yellow counties are counties that Obama carried that Bill Clinton lost. We have changing coalitions here that we'll talk about during the Q&A session. Notice that of the 3.8% national margin for Obama, but only four states were within 5 percentage points. 84% of the TV dollars was spent in seven states in the last presidential election. These are not national elections. Republicans flirt with Michigan every so often. They always end up disappointed, but they flirt, you know, see some ads early on before they retrench and pull it back into Ohio and Florida. In my state of Virginia, we're just besieged by this stuff in the Virginia markets because we're a real swing state. Republicans have, Martin will talk more about this, Republicans basically have a white coalition. They're having problems with minority voters, but they're getting a larger share of white voters. Since World War II, the president's party has lost five of six attempts for a third term. So as we start behaving more like a parliamentary system, voters start changing horses every so often and get tired of one party in power. The one thing to note about this is one thing we have seen in the last 30 years is that the one thing Republicans agree on is they do not like Democrats, and Democrats do not like Republicans. That wasn't true. And that intensity has doubled in the last 30 years. And then for those of you who are thinking, my gosh, is it going to be Donald Trump? Who's going to be the Republican presidential nominee? At this time, 8 years ago, just to say at this time, we had President Rudolph Giuliani, and right behind him, President Fred Thompson, and behind him, President Huckabee. So things moved pretty quick. 2012, at this point, we had President Newt Gingrich was doing very, very well. So this will change a lot. In the Q&A session, Martin, I can get into the weeds on that. Democratic race, Hillary Clinton had a big lead here 8 years ago. And I think I'm going to just move these. We did ask this. Would you rather have a come? What's your point of view? Are you angry, anxious? Voters are in a very ornery mood right now. They are not happy with incumbent politicians. They are very anti-establishment. And we'll get into more in the Q&A session. So we'll turn it over to Martin, and thank you.
Now, I'm Martin Frost. I'm Tom Davis's straight man. But I do want to mention one thing. My mother's family was originally from Detroit. When my mother's family came over from Lithuania in the 1870s, they moved to Detroit because there was significant Lithuanian population there. And my great-grandfather took Horace Greeley's advice and went west, young man, and he went to Texas. The rest of the family stayed in Detroit, and my family had a chain of bookstores called Marwell's. My mother's maiden name was Marwell, and they had the one at Wayne State and a number. We're not in the bookstore business anymore, but I had family in Detroit for quite a long time. But I grew up in Texas. And as Tom mentioned, he was chairman of the Republican Campaign Committee, I was chairman of the Democratic Campaign Committee. So we tend to see things structurally the same way. And I'm going to talk about what are some of the solutions to these problems that Tom has set out. First of all, on the issue of congressional districts. In fact, districts are gerrymandered badly, and so that the race is primarily, almost all the races are in the primary. What does that mean? Well, the very few people lose in a primary, but they wake up every morning in mortal fear that some crazy person, well-funded, crazy, extreme candidate in their own party is going to run against them in the primary. So they alter their voting patterns. And they're less likely to cooperate with the other side. This is true both on the Democratic and the Republican side. What we've recommended is that Congress pass a law, we're assuming Congress can still pass laws from time to time, requiring every state to appoint nonpartisan commissions to draw congressional districts. Now, only five states right now really have that. And whether Congress does it or not, states have the authority to do it on their own. Either their legislature could, or they could have it in an initiative and referendum vote, as Arizona and California did recently. So that would help. And you wouldn't have these crazy-looking districts. You might still have some that'll be a little strange-looking, but you'd have more competitive districts, and the two parties would have to talk to each other. And that's what's missing right now. Also, we recommend on the money issue, this is a little complicated, and I'll try and make it as simple as I can. As Tom mentioned, in the 1970s, Congress passed some laws regulating how money could be spent in campaigns. And they attempted to put limits on how much a candidate for House could spend and how much a candidate for the Senate could spend. And lo and behold, the Supreme Court said, no, you can't do that. That the right to spend money, to raise and spend money in a political race is a free speech issue. And so you can spend and raise as much money as you want. And individuals can give as much money as they want through an independent expenditure, not directly to the candidate. The courts did permit limits on how much an individual could give to a candidate, but some rich person could buy ads and attack a candidate or promote a candidate. And then along comes McCain-Feingold. Which took this political parties used to be able to raise money from corporations, raise money from labor unions, labor union dues money, raise money from rich individuals, but they had to report every penny of it. When I was chairman of the DCCC, this was called soft money, we had to report this money to the FEC, and Tom had to report the money that they raised to the FEC. Congress decided in its wisdom, and Tom and I were opposed to this, to take all this kind of money away from political parties, saying political parties could no longer raise what was called soft money that they used for voter turnout and sometimes for ads. And the inevitable result was that money went to these extreme groups on the right and the left that in theory can't coordinate with the candidate. That's the key here. There are two pieces here. One, a lot of this money is not reported. If it goes to what are called 501c4s, social welfare organizations, you have no idea who put up the money. And even if it goes to organizations where you have to report it, there supposedly is no coordination. That PAC, that super PAC, can't talk to the candidate and run the campaign together. So I'm going to read you something very short out of our book. I don't know if any of you are familiar with, there's a nationally known humorist who writes for The New Yorker and The New York Times. His name is Calvin Trillin. I don't know if that name means anything to you. He's a very funny guy. He's also my wife's cousin. And so Calvin wrote a column for The New York Times a couple of years ago about this issue of coordination. And I'm going to read you just a little bit from the book. He says, when super PACs were just getting started in 2012, nationally known humorist Calvin Trillin wrote a satirical piece for the New York Times on the requirement that there could be no coordination between a candidate and a super PAC. In the piece, Trillin described a mythical super PAC, America the Super, set up by the mother of mythical candidate Jeff Gold, who was running for the Senate. Trillin interviewed the PAC chief executive on the question of coordination. Trillin, well, you do understand the assumption some have that there might be more contact than the spirit of the law intends there to be, given your closeness to Mr. Gold. Super PAC CEO, my closeness? What do you mean by closeness? Trillin, because you're, well, you're his CEO, because I'm his mother? Trillin, well, yes, because you're his mother. It's natural for people to assume that the two of you often talk. CEO, he never calls, he never writes. And then this actually happened. Calvin just made this up, but it actually happened in 2014 in four different cases. During the 2014 campaign, we found out that Trillin's mythical super PAC wasn't so mythical at all. USA Today reported on July 18th, 2014, that Space PAC, a super PAC supporting the candidacy of Florida Democratic congressional candidate Gabriel Rothblatt, had raised $225,000, all of it contributed by the candidate's parent, Martine Rothblatt. Also, the Boston Herald reported on August 24, 2014, that Shirley Grossman, the mother of Massachusetts Democratic candidate for Governor Steve Grossman, gave $100,000 to a super PAC supporting her son's candidacy, Mass Forward PAC. Mrs. Grossman, 92, told the Herald, I believe in Steve. He's well-educated, honest, experienced, and all of the ideas he has are great. Candidate Grossman insisted that he had no prior knowledge of his mother's contribution. You can't make this stuff up, folks. And then there was a bipartisan phenomenon in 2014. On July 18, 2014, the Washington Post reported two examples on the Republican side. According to the Post, Mike Turner, a candidate for Congress in a Republican primary in Oklahoma, was supported by a super PAC funded by $135,000 from his mother and grandfather. Ben Sasse, a Republican candidate for the Senate in Nebraska, who's now a United States Senator, was supported by Insuring a Conservative Nebraska, a super PAC funded by $100,000 contribution from his great uncle, Rupert Dunklow. I'm his great uncle, and that's the reason, Dunklow said. So I emailed Calvin. He goes by Bud, by the way, but I emailed Calvin. And I said, yeah, Bud, do you mind if we quote from your article in our book? And he said, no, that's fine. And he said, but Martin, you know that I wrote another column. And I said, well, what's that, Bud? He said, well, I wrote about the shoe bomber. And I said, the next thing you know, there's going to be an underwear bomber. And there turned out to be an underwear bomber. So you can't make this stuff up, folks, as hard as you try. Now, what does that all mean? It means the FEC or Congress could pass some laws addressing this issue of coordination and make it clear that they can't coordinate, they can't run a common campaign because there are no limits on these outside groups on how much money they can raise from corporations, unions, and wealthy individuals. Also, a lot of this money doesn't have to be reported. Congress could pass a law saying that any organization of any kind that mentions a federal candidate by name during a two-year period leading up to an election has to report its contributors. Will Congress do that? Don't know. Congress likes the system the way it is, but there are some things that can be done. Now, if you wanted to reverse Citizens United, that's a Supreme Court's case that permitted corporations to make unlimited contributions to these outside groups, you would have to amend the Constitution, because it's a question of, it's in a constitutional interpretation that money equals speech. So, and it's damn hard to amend the Constitution in this country. It requires a two-thirds vote of each House and a three-quarters ratification by the Senate. So there are limited remedies, but we have to do something about this amount of money in politics today, because it has totally distorted the system. And again, when you combine that with safe states or with safe districts, then it makes it, there's an incentive for people never to cooperate with the other side, because they're afraid some far right or far left group at the very last minute will come in and dump $2 million on their head in the closing days of a race. Good example, my friend Pat Roberts. I don't know if anybody knows who Pat is. Pat is a United States Senator from Kansas. My wife is originally from Kansas. And Pat served in the House with me. He's a decent guy, he's a Republican, decent guy. And Kansas has a history of having elected moderate United States Senators, Bob Dole, Elizabeth Kassebaum, some interesting people out of Kansas, moderate Republicans. However, he had a Tea Party opponent in the primary this last time. So Pat moved hard right, didn't want to be seen in public with a Democrat, wouldn't cooperate with Democrats on anything. He survived the election. He beat the Tea Party candidate, but it was a close race. And then he had a close general election because he'd been moving all over the ballpark, but he was elected. But it tends to influence the behavior of people in public office when this is permitted to go on. Now, one of the other things that Tom and I have suggested is we really need to do things to increase turnout. You have very low turnouts in primaries. In that way, a well-organized, well-funded extreme group can control the primary. What's a solution for that? Well, you could have all primaries for the House and the Senate, not for president, they can do the presidential thing whenever they want to in states, but all congressional primaries and senatorial primaries on the same day, everywhere in the country. That would mean you'd have more media attention, there'd be more interest, and presumably you'd have a larger voter turnout. Also, Tom and I have suggested something which is a little bit controversial in certain circles, and that is returning to something called earmarks. There was a system at one time which members of the House and the Senate could specify how certain portions of the money appropriated by Congress would be spent in their districts. Now, there were some abuses under this system. There was a fellow from San Diego, Randy Duke Cunningham, who was a classmate of mine at the University of Missouri. I didn't know him in school, I didn't know him. And he actually sold these earmarks to defense contractors, took bribes. He was convicted in federal court, as he should have been, and got to spend some time as a guest of the government in a federal penitentiary. I mean, that shouldn't happen. There also were some examples of unusual projects, the Bridge to Nowhere, things like this. Now, what's the solution? Well, the solution is permit members of Congress and the Senate to earmark projects if they put their name on it in the committee report, and it can only be in their district or in their state. Now, what are some examples? Those of you who traveled to Washington, there's something called the Woodrow Wilson Bridge, which connects Tom's district in Virginia to D.C. Bridge was about to fall down. If you live in Virginia, you could only get to D.C. by going across one of four bridges. The Woodrow Wilson Bridge was one of them. Tom got an earmark to have that bridge rebuilt, and in fact, it was rebuilt, and it's helped congestion quite a bit. The business community in Dallas, Texas, the city I represented, came to me a number of years ago and said, Martin, Dallas is the largest city in the country without mass transit. We would like to have a mass transit system. So I got an earmark for an above ground light rail system, which has been built. It's called Dallas Area Rapid Transit, which is now one of the best light rail systems in the country. So these things can be constructive, but members ought to own them. They ought to have their name on them, and they ought to be limited to the areas they represent. We recommend a number of other things, too. Tom made the basic point, and I want to go back to this because it is so important. Tom made the point that voters are now acting like we're in a parliamentary system. Now, what does that mean? In many places in Europe and other parts of the world, you have parliamentary government. That is the majority party, or the coalition of parties that controls the parliament, also gets the prime minister. So you have unified government. And so you actually can get things done. And if people don't like it, then they throw the whole group out, and they have unified government on the other side. We don't have that in this country. It's more often than not, as Tom mentioned, that you have a president of one party and at least one house of the other of the Congress controlled by the other party. That's provided, it's checks and balance. It's been a good system for us. but it has some problems, particularly when voters are thinking that they're in a parliamentary system and that they're going to get unified government if they just vote straight party, but they don't get unified government because that's not the way our system works out. So we have a lot of problems here. We are optimists. We may not, what we've said may not sound very optimistic, but we believe in our system. We have a great country. Our system of government has done, has performed pretty well over the years. Our system is such that no one can ride into town on a white horse one day and change everything. When I talk to college kids and high school kids, I make the point that we were created in a revolution, the United States. But those revolutionaries then created a very conservative form of government, a form of government making it hard to pass laws, hard to change things. And that's one of the reasons we've been had such a stable government. That's served us well over the years, but now structurally we've got some problems where that doesn't work very well. Now, we're going to stop. Tom and I will try and answer all your questions. I would ask that you stand up so we can hear you when you ask a question. And if any of you happen to have been from Texas at one point, I'd be interested. And if any of you happen to be from Northern Virginia, I know Tom would be interested too. And then we'll be out in front signing copies of the books when it's over. Thank you very much.
All right, who wants the first question?
And Tom is for Kasich for president. And Kasich's a decent guy. I served with him in the House. And he's about 4% in the polls right now, but Tom is optimistic. And I'm for Hillary, so let's leave it at that. Okay.
All right, who wants the first question? Go ahead.
If you could go to the mic, so that makes it easier. There's a mic in the back.
Yes, fine. Go ahead.
Hi, my name's Jim Osborne, and I have a couple of questions. The first one is, you made the comment about how we have a system of checks and balances, and how would you square that with a lot of the executive actions that our current president is doing?
It's an interesting question. We have a chapter in the book about that. Tom, it was Tom's idea to write this chapter, so I'll let him start.
Well, look, I think what's happened is the legislative branch being unable to produce a product, by default, somebody's going to fill the vacuum. And the executive branch has stepped in through regulations, through executive orders, and the like, to try to fill the vacuum and get some things moving. The irony, and Martin talked about earmarks, the one power Congress has is the power of the purse, and they've punted on that, allowing the executive branch to designate where the money goes, by giving up the earmark process. I know earmarks have a bad name, but somebody somewhere has to designate where the money goes. And what's happened under the current system is Congress has punted because you had people who thought earmarks were so bad and were adding to spending, which it doesn't. And so they've allowed the executive branch that authority as well. So if the congressional branch can't get a product done, somebody's going to fill that vacuum and the executive branch has stepped in. It's unfortunate. It's been a huge transfer of power. And the checks and the balances now, Congress is the weak sister in the three levels of government the way it's currently
chapter operating. 15, it's called the big punt. And the answer to your question, though, is if the executive does this, there is still a check on the executive. For example, the president has tried to do some things on immigration reform by executive order. That's being challenged in the courts. And he may lose in the courts. I don't know how it's going to turn out, but our courts do have a say on this. So the president doesn't have unlimited power, but Congress has ceded an awful lot of power by not acting on immigration. For years and years, Congress has just said, oh, we can't deal with it, it's too hard. And so the president finally said, oh, you can't deal with it? Well, I'm going to deal with it. And that we would rather have Congress deal with those issues.
Yeah, I oppose the executive order. And I also think, I mean, the Republicans went to a judge and a circuit where they were more likely to win. There's a lot of form shopping going on now when you go to court. You can almost tell who appointed them how the outcome's going to come, unfortunately.
But Congress is at fault for not acting in certain areas, and then you have an activist president. That activist president could be a Democrat or he could be a Republican who's then stepped into the breach.
Yeah, I just add that, just to add my Republican bona fides, this. Just because Congress doesn't act and they don't pass a law doesn't mean the president can make a law. And I think that's where they've stepped in. But their inability to get some things done on budget and everything else, I think, has kind of weakened the institution.
Yeah. Okay, you got a lady
behind you.
You want to
follow? Let me have a follow-up.
the question that I really wanted to ask was about the way districts are comprised. How much do computer programs have to do with comprising the makeup of a district?
Well, I'll start on that one because I got my start in politics. I was a journalism major at the University of Missouri, which is at a very fine journalism school. My first job was on the Wilmington, Delaware News Journal right out of college. And the case of Reynolds versus Sims was the, in 1964, was the case that required equal population districts for legislatures. Baker versus Carr had been 2 years before in Congress. So Reynolds versus Sims was decided almost the day I started working for the newspaper in Wilmington, Delaware. And so there were some computer geeks out at Atlas Chemical, some PhDs, who were using computers to draw congressional districts. Nobody had ever done that before. And so I wrote a couple of stories about that. And then I took those stories to a magazine in Washington. I really wanted to work in Washington. And they looked at that and they said, oh, well, we'll hire you. So that helped me get a job in Washington. Computers can do all kinds of wonderful things. You can tell a computer that you want this district to be 55% Democratic by previous voting patterns. And you can tell it generally what the boundaries should be, and the computer will draw it for you. Now, that doesn't mean that you should automatically take that. And in fact, Iowa has a system where you have technicians using computers who draw districts, but with certain parameters. They have to look nice. They can't cross county lines. You know, they have to be compact. So it depends on who programs the computer and what instructions are put in. There's nothing inherently wrong with computers being used to draw equal population districts, but it's what you tell the computer to do.
Yeah, and the data analytics is so far advanced now that if one party is controlling it to their advantage, which happens in a majority of the states, they can draw it with some precision. I'll just add as an anecdote, we add it in the book. In 19, I had a fairly heavily Democratic district that I beat a Democratic incumbent and survived four terms there with comfortable margins, but I was always a little uncomfortable because my presidential candidate was always losing my district. And I figured, you know, they put enough money in me, and over time, now as chairman of the Republican Campaign Committee, it may catch up with me. So in 2001, the legislature had to redraw the districts. Fortunately for me, my wife was the chairman of the committee in the state house that drew the districts, and she took care of it.
And anyway, so
I didn't invent the system. I'm just saying.
And she made sure he didn't get too many Republicans, so he wouldn't have a Republican challenge.
Too many Republicans, I'd have a primary, so I had to be careful.
Anyway, now look, the problem is what the Republicans did in 2010. There is nothing illegal about what they did. They did something very smart. They put an enormous amount of money into electing people to state legislatures in states like Michigan and electing Republican governors so that they controlled redistricting in states that went Democratic for president. So they actually got to draw districts, got more districts that they were entitled to because they controlled the process. Democrats could do the same thing.
They did in Illinois. They did in Michigan.
And who's to say that in the next round the Democrats couldn't put a lot of money in and take back a lot of legislatures and draw a lot of democratically gerrymandered districts? We're not for that. We want the people to have a chance to actually have some fair fight districts and so that people have to talk to each other.
Well, let me just, if you'll just permit me a second.
Yeah.
To explore this just one step further. Oh, it's down now. Well, anyway.
It's all right.
You saw those district maps. Do they pass the laugh test?
No.
They don't pass the laugh test. It's so far out of hand now. Somebody's got to come in and just say, come on. You know, there've got to be certain limits.
All right.
The courts did this in Baker versus Carr and Reynolds versus Sims because you had districts, 900,000 in one district, 200,000 in a district adjacent. And that was in Texas where
the legislature,
the 900,000 was the only Republican
seat
in Texas. Yeah. But the court stepped in. And I think sooner or later this thing gets so unbalanced, but the public doesn't seem to care. And so politicians don't respond generally until there's a price.
The lady in the red sweater, yes.
Orange, whatever color.
My name is Marina Whitman. In all the discussion of the concern about the enormous amount of campaign spending that goes on, the major culprit usually pointed to is Citizens United, which said that corporations have the right of free speech like persons.
Right.
But as far as I know, and I may be wrong and you can correct me, large public corporations, by and large, with perhaps some exceptions like the oil industry, do not tend to come out strongly in favor of one.
Yeah, you are exactly correct.
They hedge their bets.
But there are a lot of privately held corporations that put a lot of money, corporate money in. I'm going to give you an example to prove your point. In the 1980s, there was a hotly contested Senate race in North Carolina. Jesse Helms, very conservative Republican, was running for re-election. He had a very good African-American mayor of Charlotte running against him. Michael Jordan, the basketball great, went to the University of North Carolina. He was asked to contribute to the Democratic candidate, the mayor of Charlotte, in that race.
Who's African-American?
He was African-American. Michael Jordan had just become the spokesman for Nike. And Michael Jordan refused to contribute to the black Democrat, and his response was, Republicans buy sneakers too. Now later, when Michael Jordan became more secure, he did support Barack Obama in 2008. But early in his business career, he was very concerned about the issue you just raised, that corporations don't want to have too high a profile in politics, but there are a lot of privately held corporations that put a lot of money in, and there are some publicly held corporations that do too, although less so.
But couldn't people like the Koch brothers, yes, which is one of the best known?
They're proud of it. They like. Want everybody to know.
I know that. I saw the article this morning. But couldn't they, as individuals anyway, have contributed?
Yes.
Yes. The answer to the question is, what you have to do is you have to also limit what individuals can give, because the same, for a long time, the free speech argument was applied by the court only to individuals making large contributions. It was Citizen United that then stood that on its head and applied it to corporations and to labor union dues money. But the right of an individual to make large contributions, not directly to a candidate, could never give directly to the candidate, but give to groups that were in coordination with the candidate, loose, very tight coordination, that has existed for a long time. So either you change the coordination regulations or you have a constitutional amendment limiting the right of both individuals and corporations to make large contributions to these political organizations.
And just to take it in the weeds a little further, it was not Citizens United that led to these super PACs. It was a case called Speech Now.
Which was after Citizens United.
Which was after that, and it was an FEC interpretation of Citizens United, and it was never went to the Supreme Court. It was the D.C. Circuit Court of Appeals, which has jurisdiction over the Federal Election Commission, which, by the way, deadlocks on party line votes on everything, so they get they don't do anything. They don't get anything done.
So
I think Citizens United somehow
opened the door. It
opened, but it gets easily demonized because you can raise money off it.
Now,
ironically.
Now, this is the Wild West in politics now. Extraordinary amount of money being spent, and it's distorted our system, and it's made it more, as Tom and I have both pointed out, it's made it more difficult for people to compromise because they are worried that they will have a large amount of money, outside money, dumped on their heads in a party primary and that they'll lose to someone more extreme.
The question ultimately is, why should candidates and parties be limited and nobody else is limited? That's the outcome of all these reform things, and it doesn't work.
Yeah, behind you. But that was a very good question.
Yeah, go ahead.
My name is Alan Reinstein. I live in Farmington Hills. I used to live in Ann Arbor.
Get close to the mic, so you can hear.
I used to live in Ann Arbor when I was young and liberal, and I changed, thank God. I'm making money. Why should I be liberal? But the question I have is, one of you guys mentioned the idea that there should be a law of how states gerrymander or don't gerrymander districts. Is that a constitutional?
The answer is yes. We've talked to constitutional authorities. Congress has the authority to require states to use nonpartisan commissions, if they choose to, but they've not chosen to so far.
They can do proportional. There are a lot of tools in the toolbox that Congress has. But why would Congress change? They all got elected under these current rules.
And let me take it one step farther. There were some Republicans in Arizona. Arizona has a commission who didn't like the lines drawn by the commission. The commission had been created by a statewide referendum vote, not by the legislature. And they took the case all the way to the Supreme Court on taking the position that that the only person who can pass, the only body that can pass a law governing this is the legislature, and that you can't do it by a direct vote of the people through referendum. The Supreme Court, in a 5-4 decision, rejected that argument and said you could create, if those states that have initiative and referendum, not all states do, that you could, by a vote of the people, create a nonpartisan commission, or the legislature could, either one.
I've read the Constitution a long time. Doesn't the Constitution say that the states decide how they
The states draw the district, but Congress can tell them.
He's asking another question. The states, under the Constitution, the states have the first crack at how elections are conducted.
Right.
Under the Constitution. But the Constitution provides that Congress can override that. States get the first crack at it, but the...
I'll give you a simple example. For many years until...
it's in a particular article we cite in the book, in the Constitution.
I'll give you an example. This, the age of voting. Until around 1970, some states had 18, some had 20, some had 21.
Congress
had to have a constitutional amendment to change it. Why would this be any different?
Well, Congress used that for the age of voting,
right.
But they only did that for federal elections. State elections could be, states could do whatever they wanted.
For whatever reason, Congress did not try and do it by statute and did it by constitutional amendment. That's all I can tell you. But there is, constitutional scholars agree that Congress does have the authority, if it so chooses to do so, to require nonpartisan commissions for drawing lines. Yeah, okay. It's a good question. Yeah.
I need to get shorter, I guess. I served 45 years in public office, elected public office, and I'm not going to ever do that again.
You're a slow learner, though, right?
Well, it worked well, but for the reasons that you two both said so well, I don't want to get back into that again. Tom, please don't drop your voice at the end of the sentence. Did you ever take a speech class?
That only applies to people like you and me who are older. Tom's not as old as we are. And okay. So I have to tell my wife that all the time. Don't drop your last sentence. Don't drop the last word in the question because I can't hear it.
Well, that's why I missed half of your very good points.
Okay.
I wish that everybody here buys this book and reads it and pays attention, because the problem that you're both stressing is so desperately important.
We appreciate that.
And if you don't do it, who is going to?
Well, there are a lot of people in the country who are raising these issues. We're not the only one. We just decided that we felt very strongly about it and that we would put it in writing and then travel around the country talking about it. By the way, if they run out of books, you can get it on Amazon also. But if you get it tonight, we'll sign it. Okay. You've got a couple other people.
I had one election where the total amount I spent was $500.
What you spent running?
My opponent spent $13,000.
Wow.
I won.
Hard to do that today.
In a small townish area.
Right, it can be done in a small district.
Where people go on your reputation mostly, this can happen. But you go into big cities, where people don't even know the names of apartment owners on the same floor of the same building, the money seems to be all important.
It's a good point. We could kind of level the playing field a little bit.
Well, small town areas don't have that problem. In the big cities, it's a disaster.
Yeah, it's a good point. Okay, you got somebody behind you right there. I believe he's a Michigan fan. I can see by the thing around his neck. Okay, go ahead.
Sir, I was wondering, it's very interesting, the discussion, both of you. it seems that the Congress is deadlocked. You know, people just don't believe in voting and other things like that. And what you're doing is very good with your book. But are there other things that we can do to change the culture, the diversity part of America?
Well, let me add, I watch people on Election Day walk out in November with an I voted pin, a button. Did you get that little sticker when you leave? You feel so proud. In most of these districts, it doesn't matter. The election was over in the primary. So how many of you vote in primaries? And the question is, if you don't vote in primaries, look, a lot of independents, liberals and conservatives have passion. They show up. Moderates have lives. And if you see where I'm going with this. And so you get turnouts in some of these areas that are less than 10% that are determining what candidates the rest of us get to vote for in November. And if you have larger primary turnouts, some states prohibit independents from voting.
In primaries.
And so they don't. And other places they're allowed to, they just don't. So the elections belong to who shows up. And if the election is the primary, find a way to show up. In my state, there's no party registration. So you can pick your party.
Same in Texas.
And you can switch from election to election. Massachusetts, a heavily Democratic state, 52% of the registered voters are independents. But they're allowed to vote they're allowed to pick the primary. And they get active, but they tend to not vote in the primaries. You get the hardcore going out. So the most important thing I can say is pay attention to the primary election, because that decides what your choices will be in November.
Also, when your particular member of Congress has a public meeting, town hall meeting, speaks to the Rotary Club, speaks at a church, wherever they speak, go to those meetings and raise the issue about what can be done institutionally to make Congress work better. They need to hear it from the public. They need to know that there are a lot of people out there who are not just mad, but who would like some changes made. So talk to your member of Congress. I know it's not always possible.
Most of them don't even do town meetings anymore. They do the electronic town meetings. They get to screen it, the phone calls. But if you get a chance, do it.
Yeah, but if your congressman comes and you're a member of the Rotary Club or the Lions Club or whatever organization you belong to, the Realtors, and your congressman comes to speak to your group, go to the meeting and raise some issues, raise some questions.
And that kind of addresses the question I was going to raise with the current paralysis that the legislative process is in. How do these reforms get enacted or even...
The public has to get mad enough and push hard enough for them. We have had movements in this country. You know, it's very interesting. I speak to a lot of kids, high school, junior high school. I even spoke to elementary school kids when I was in Congress, and people would say, "Why do you do that, Martin?" I said, "Well, they're going to be 18 pretty soon, and I plan to serve for a while." But you talk to young people, and you tell them that prior to 1920, women couldn't vote in the United States. They look at you like, "You must be from some foreign country, some other planet. What do you mean women couldn't vote?" That's right, they couldn't vote. And African Americans couldn't vote for a very long time in this country. So it takes a lot of people pushing very hard for there to be change. We believe in our country. This is a great country. We believe change is possible, but you better yell pretty loud to get some change made right now.
Yeah, go ahead.
This is presidential season. It takes, we're about a year away, but we're hot into the presidential election fever. My question is this. Donald Trump, for example, is running a very strong campaign, and up to yesterday seemed to be the number one vote preference for many Republicans. My question specifically is, Donald Trump is really not a true Republican. He's sort of an independent. Ross Perot was a third-party candidate.
He was from my city of Dallas, but he also happened to be a little nutty. That was Perot's problem.
My question is there any future for a third party in this country? I know it's very, very difficult to think about it, but what are your thoughts about this?
What about someone being elected as a third-party candidate?
Yes.
Tom, you want to try? I have some thoughts about it, but let Tom talk too.
Well, the parties are weaker today than at any time certainly in the last half century, because they used to control the money and everything, and now the money's opened up. under these court decisions. So you get a rich guy, a Bloomberg or somebody like that, or somebody that has the backings of some wealthy backers, they can get even pretty quick in terms of getting their message out. Parties do offer an organization that a candidate can step into. They offer a group of loyalists that are there election after election. And for the most part, the Republicans have nailed down pretty hard the right, and the Democrats pretty much the left. Now, if the Republicans nominate two centrist a candidate, it's possible that the right could revolt and find a candidate, and the same with the Democrats on the left. So I think it's more fluid now than it has been at any time in my lifetime for a third party. And if you continue to get the dysfunctional outcomes out of the body politic that we have gotten over the last decade, you may see independent candidates crop up. It's happened in countries where candidates come out of the blue and win as third party because people get so frustrated. It could certainly happen here.
But talk about ballot access in Virginia and some other states. So that's
in Virginia, ballot access is hard. You've got to get several hundred signatures from each congressional district, a total statewide of 5,000. It was three times that 4 years ago. And only two candidates made the primary ballot, the same for general elections. So, and you have timing on ballot access issues for independent candidates that if they start too late, they can't really get on the ballot in some of these states. So you got to start early. It takes a lot of money and organization. And parties have an organization ready to go.
Parties automatically
and ballot access. And a branding that independents don't. But, no, I think independents can be very viable. We have two members of the Senate that were elected as independents at this point. We've had a number of governors elected as independents. You have an independent governor of Alaska right now. And when things get really bad and voters get fed up, there's nothing to stop them from turning a third party. And I've told our colleagues in Congress, guys, this gets too bad. They'll go a different direction than you want to go. And so I think it's possible.
Also, the Electoral College is stacked against having a third-party candidate. It's winner-take-all. Whoever gets a plurality of the vote in almost every state gets all the electoral votes. Now, there are one or two states where they divide their electoral votes by congressional district, but it's very hard for an independent to win enough states to get any significant number of electoral votes. Ross Perot didn't get a single electoral vote, spent a hell of a lot of money. And some of these other independent candidates have spent a lot of money and gotten little or no electoral votes.
And on top of that, if you don't get a majority, it goes to the House of Representatives.
That's really scary.
Where the two parties dominate. And that was the problem in 1968, where the Nixon folks were nervous Wallace would throw it into the House, into Congress, which is Democratic.
But it's structured so that each state gets one vote. So it depends on how many delegations you get.
But there are no independents in Congress, is my point.
That's right. But they could vote for the independent if they wanted to.
Yeah, wouldn't. They'd be writing their obituary.
Yeah, anyway, go ahead. Yeah.
Coming tonight. It's been very interesting.
Get close to the mic so we can hear.
Thank you for coming tonight. It's been very, very interesting. I wanted to ask a couple of questions. Which ones are the five states that you mentioned that have the bipartisan voting?
Washington, California, Arizona, Iowa, and New Jersey.
Okay. Thank you. And Michigan, I believe, maybe some of you know this, but I don't believe that in the primaries we can vote like if we're independents or anything. Is that correct?
I don't know whether you can. You have to vote. Is it party registration?
Don't you have to be in a party in order to vote in the primaries
or
not?
It varies from state to state.
Okay, so Michigan in that sense. Okay, very good. Thank you very much.
Okay.
My name is Claire Dahl, and I'm finding this incredibly interesting. Well, just one observation. I tend to think that if Congress stayed in Washington a little bit longer during the week, they might get to know each other. You know, they fly in on Tuesday morning, they go back to their own states and districts on Thursday. Their kids don't go to school together, they don't know each other, and the only time they interact is when they're on opposite sides of the aisle. And I think maybe we should force them to stay in D.C. and get to know each other.
Well, I'll start.
My real question is, do you think that anything can come of Paul Ryan possibly becoming the Speaker of the House? If Boehner decided to, you know, drop out because he couldn't corral the cats, can Paul Ryan, is there any hope of somebody getting the parties to kind of talk even within themselves to get things?
Okay, I'll take the first part of the question since since Ryan's a Republican, I'll let Tom take the second part. When I was elected in 1978, I moved my family to Washington. A lot of people had their families in Washington, a lot of congressmen did. It was somewhat helpful. My kids went to the same, they went to public schools, they went to the same schools as children of members of Congress of both parties in Northern Virginia. We stayed around a lot more, we weren't gone every weekend. But that alone is not going to solve the problem. It would be nice if Congress were in session 5 days a week. They had to work like everybody else, and that they did get to spend some time together on bipartisan retreats. But that alone is not going to solve the problem. Tom, you want to talk about Ryan?
Well, let me first of all say on spending more time together, I think it's always helpful.
Yeah.
If you get to know the other person and you know their family, it's harder to demonize them. Congress has gone the opposite way, unfortunately. We passed these really strict ethics rules that really make it almost impossible now for members to get together in bipartisan settings, as we used to have bipartisan retreats where you'd bring your families up, you'd meet in the morning and you could take your families to Hershey Park, or we'd meet
at some resort. They were paid for by private funds.
But, yeah, by private funds. You can't do any of, well, members aren't going to, they don't make enough to do that, you know, on their own. So you got to make it easy. It really helped things. Because you got to know the person on the other side, you got to talk really behind closed doors, so we didn't have the media saying, oh, he said the wrong thing, or he gave this up. I mean, members are on a tightrope right now in terms of what they dare say and what talk radio is going to eat them up on if they just go off the party line a little bit. The other thing that Speaker Boehner did is he took away most of these what we call CODELs, these trips to foreign countries. I mean, some people call them junkets, but I found them very helpful. Sometimes just to get to know your colleagues because you're on a plane and you're on a trip with them for a week. They're allowed to take their wives. And that built, I think, some comradeship that you don't get anymore either. Now they fly commercial. And you're not together to the same extent. And I think the fact that they're there so short a period of time is more a manifestation of the problem than a cause of the problem. I think the causes are what we put up here. But it would certainly help. I don't think there's any question about that.
What about Ryan?
Now, Paul Ryan is a remarkable young man. He was in his 20s when he got elected, a Republican from a district that had traditionally had a lot of Democrats in it. Janesville, the town he's from, is a Democratic town. Paul is one of the most earnest members I ever met in Congress, where he was not really political. He wasn't always trying to get the other side and trying to stick it to them. He's a policy wonk. He's probably to the right of center of most Americans on his economics. But he's sincere. He knows his stuff. And he was uniquely able to get a majority of the conference, 218 members, to vote for him on the floor. Voting for Boehner on the floor became very difficult because talk radio had demonized him and it made him out to be something else. And members were afraid to vote for him and go back to their districts. Their hardcore conservative base, Boehner was demonized to them. But Ryan just ran for vice president. And all these people voted for Ryan for vice president. How can you say he's qualified for vice president, which is second in line, but he's not qualified for speaker, which is third in line? So he has, I think, a lot of gravitas within the conference to get there. Now, the problems that Boehner had in corralling people to vote for compromise, they still remain. It's exactly what we talked about up here. It's talk radio, it's cable news, it's the primary, it's super PACs, it's people whose business models are to polarize and divide, not to seek solutions. But he starts off, I think, anew. Boehner is clearing up some of the tough issues behind him, like raising the debt ceiling and getting what we call our 502A allocation set for the budget numbers for the next year and a half. So I think the next year and a half here will be fine. If you get a Republican president, at that point you will see more parliamentary action, the Republicans acting in unison, and he could actually be a success of this. But the same problems that plagued Boehner plague Ryan, but because he ran for vice president and he is such a policy wonk, members really look to him. And I'd say this other thing about Paul Ryan, he thinks for himself. A lot of these members are robots. They go like this, or where's talk radio? Where are the super PACs? Paul Ryan has never hesitated to cross over if he thinks it's the wrong vote. I'll give you two examples, and people may or may not disagree with this. Maybe I'm costing him support when I mention this. We had a bill up, the End Discrimination Employment Act, that basically said you can't discriminate against gays and lesbians in the workplace. And most Republicans they voted against it. It was kind of reflexive. And I'm from a pretty progressive district on those issues. And I voted for it, and I said, has anybody looked at the polling on this thing? It's an 80%. And members said, well, you know, my church people are saying this, or I've got the Christian Coalition saying it. Ryan said, I don't have any problem with this, and voted for it, and he just matter of fact about it. He's very pro-life, very traditional, but he had no problem with that and didn't care where the crowd was going. The other was on voting rights for the District of Columbia. District of Columbia citizens have fought and died in 9 wars. They pay federal income taxes, but they don't get a vote in Congress. I sponsored a bill that would give them a vote in Congress. By the way, it allowed two more seats in Congress, which Congress can do by statute, and the other seat would have been Utah, so you would have been adding a Republican seat and a Democratic seat. Most Republicans, again, reflexively against it because D.C. would clearly be a Democratic vote. Ryan said, I don't have a problem with this. They're American citizens, they're entitled to a vote. It was one of 23 Republicans that joined with me. Unpopular vote in the conference. Ryan is a guy that thinks for himself. And he's a disciple of Jack Kemp, who was a big picture Republican. I like Paul Ryan. I think the world of him, and I wish him the best of luck. But the underpinnings of what caused Speaker Boehner problems are still there.
The question is, how long a honeymoon will he have?
Well, I think he gets a
honeymoon.
Boehner's clearing out a lot of the tough issues.
Not all of them.
Debt ceiling and your spending allocations for 2 years. That makes a huge difference.
So we'll see. We wish him well. We don't wish him ill at all. Go ahead.
Well, that was my short answer. I could keep going
We're going to stop in just a minute because we want to go out and sign some books. Go ahead.
Bob Shaw.
David Walker, Comptroller General, said we had a debt problem. Simpson Bowles said we had a debt problem. If you go read the latest CBO report looking at the next 10 years of the 16 budget, the CBO says our deficits, not our debt, in the early 20s will start exceeding $1 trillion a year. How do we fix that?
All right, let me answer that because I feel pretty strongly about this. Congress, no surprise here, screwed it up. The Simpson-Bowles Commission was created by Congress, a vote of Congress. And it was sailing along so that all you had to do was to get a majority of the Simpson-Bowles members, and then there would be an automatic up or down vote in the Congress to approve them or disapprove them. The United States Senate, at the last minute, did away with that provision, required that there be a two-thirds majority on Simpson-Bowles for their recommendations to be submitted for a vote. They got a majority, they didn't get two-thirds, and I'm a Democrat. My president refused to push Congress to vote on the Simpson-Bowles issue, either up or down. It was a mistake. We have enormous problems, budgetary problems, not the least of which involves 70-80% of the people in this room, the future, and I'm including myself, the future of Medicare and the future of Social Security. They are an increasingly larger percentage of the budget every year. When you add into that the interest on the national debt, and then you add in defense spending, there's very, very little left for domestic discretionary spending, which is where all the good things come from out of government. So somehow we've got to address this. We can't just let those programs swallow the entire budget. Social Security is a great program. We're a better country because we have Social Security. But maybe we need to raise the age a little bit. We raised it in 1983 when I was in Congress. We raised the retirement age from 65 to 67. Maybe we need to raise it to 68, phase it in over a few years. And that time, we didn't even start it for 20 years, and then we phased it in over a period of years. On Medicare, maybe we need to figure out how we can make some changes in Medicare. It's a wonderful program. I'm on Medicare. My wife is on Medicare. We love Medicare. But you can't have Social Security and Medicare swallow up the entire budget of the United States.
And Medicaid.
Medicaid is for poor people, yeah.
But Medicaid also, about 70% of that goes to seniors for nursing home beds.
Yeah.
Let me say, we're an airplane flying into a mountain. This is unsustainable, our spending. I could spend an hour on each of these issues dealing with it, and it's very frustrating because you're not going to solve this by just making budget cuts. And you're not going to solve it by just raising revenue on the rich. But these are fallacies. Neither one even gets close to it. The problem is each side is dug in. One side said, we're not raising taxes. The other side said, we're not going to cut your benefits. You're going to have to do everything. And by the way, every day you put this off,
it's harder.
Yeah, your options become worse. And it is just extremely frustrating. Someday we'll get a leader who will step up and bring people together. But as we noted here, compromise is very tough for these folks at this point. And if you can't compromise, you can't solve it.
It may be, and we're going to stop, but we'll let the lady ask one more.
Sure.
But it may be that we have to have a president who says at the front end, and who means it, I will only serve one term. And that, so then the president's not worried about re-election.
Well, he doesn't have to say it, but he can think it in his mind.
No, he ought to say it, and he ought to mean it.
He ought to
mean it. I'll only serve one term, and then maybe you'll have a president who will have a little more courage.
My question is this. Do you think we'll ever come to a day where the people who vote in the primary are people who are not brought there by virtue of a dog whistle? Something that has nothing to do with their well-being, but has everything to do with being a very hard-bitten thing that gets talked about by politicians during the election season, and then you don't hear about it again.
It's an interesting question.
That is a great question. And I think leadership can bring out the best in voters sometimes. I just don't see it right now. I see this thing going to the lowest common denominator in all of these debates and everything else. But I've seen, look, I was a county executive. I ran a race, tried to stay up here and won in a Democratic county against a Democratic incumbent 2-1. And was able, we were selected best financially managed county in the country. Made a lot of changes. And I didn't say I was going to serve one term, but I thought in my mind, I'm willing to do one term if we can straighten it out. Yeah, it's leadership though. I believe that a candidate that appeals to the best in people and stays on it can win, and you can win a primary. But it's very hard when you're on a stage with 12 people, and it's kind of a race to the bottom into interest groups and so on. But I think eventually, you know, that can emerge, and I think when you call on people, even primary voters, that can happen. But it takes a remarkable individual with, with outstanding leadership qualities to bring that up. We have them in a number of states. We have them in a handful of mayors that have emerged and turned cities around. So I think it can happen, and I think it will happen, and we're both optimists on this kind of thing. Yeah. So it's a great question, though.
Okay, we'll take one more, and then we've got to go back out to the front.
My name's David Wilkening, and I just came from California 3 years ago. I worked in the state legislature for 39 and a half years.
They have term limits.
That's a staffer.
They have a bunch of rookies.
And I've looked at the commission. I used to do reapportionment too at one time when it was by the legislators, and then the commission came through. I think the problem that most people don't understand about reapportionment too is that it's based on population, number of people. Like in California, you have 600,000 people in a congressional district. But of those 600,000, maybe only 20% to 25% get the vote for the representative. So what do you do in those cases where a congressional district is made and then you have, maybe you get 25,000?
Let me start with that, and I'm going to end with a story and then turn it over to Martin. I love this question because you do have areas where you have a lot of people that are undocumented and they count under the census. And so we just look at the census. At one point in our Constitution, as you know, we didn't do that. Slaves were 3/5 of a person for percentages. And that was one of the compromises to come out of Philadelphia, where the South didn't want to lose the representation in the House. And the North said, well, you know, they're slaves. Are you going to count them? And so they compromised at 3/5. But today, everybody counts, non-citizens. And so you have these enclaves in these urban areas where you have a lot of non-citizens voting there and
not
very
voting,
low
not
turnouts.
Voting, not voting.
Very, what'd you?
C- counted but not voting.
They're counted for the census,
yeah, but
they
don't
can't
vote. They don't vote.
And so you have very low vote counts in some of those. In others, you just have people that are all citizens, but it varies, and you don't take that into account in drawing districts. It's not based on the number of voters. Now, Congress fights over the census. I was chairman of the committee in charge of the census. And how you count people is also very important. How you find these people. At one point, we had to bring suit in the House against the Clinton administration on their sampling. They wanted to sample because they thought they'd get higher numbers in urban areas, and we won that suit. But we compromised and did some outreach into these areas. So I'm going to end with one quick story, and then I'm going to turn it over to Martin. In the last census, one census ago, there was a town in West Virginia where the highest percent in the country of people over 100 years old existed. It was a significant percentage.
This is a long story.
It's not that long.
Maybe you can shorten it.
It's not that long, Martin. Just help cool it. It's worth listening to. So Dan Rather went out and starts interviewing these people. This is a town in West Virginia. Was it the cool mountain air and fresh water? Was it the genetics, the lack of stress? He wasn't sure. So he goes down the street and he sees this really old geezer. And he says, "Sir, how old are you?" And the guy said, "I'm 102. He said, "Well, what's your secret to long life?" And the guy said, "Dan, that's easy." He said, "I don't smoke. I don't drink. I don't gamble. I don't chase women." He said, "That's it." He said, "That's my secret." He said, "Great." Went around the corner, saw an even older looking guy. He said, "Sir, how old are you?" The guy said, "I'm 104. He said, "That's incredible. What's your secret to long life?" Same thing. Guy says, "I don't smoke. I don't drink. I don't gamble. And I don't chase women." Walk down another block, sees an even older looking guy. At this point, Rather's got it figured out. He said, "Sir, let me ask you a question. Is the fact you've lived so long the fact you don't smoke, drink, gamble, or chase women?" The guy said, "Are you kidding?" He said, "I smoke 3 packs a day." He said, "I drink a couple 6-packs during the day, and I get down as much hooch as I can at night." He said, "I grab any woman that comes near me, and by the way, I'm on my way over to a poker game right now. You want to join me?" Rather said, "That's incredible." He said, "How old are you?" The guy said, "I'm 26. So, go ahead.
All right. All right. On that note, we've enjoyed being with you. We'll be out in front, and thank you very much for having us.
That was really, really good. As a political science major, Christmas came early for me this year, so thank you for that. So as a token of our appreciation, we have a special gift for each of you, a pen set with Gerald Ford's signature on it.
I used to have golf balls with Tip O'Neill's signature on them, but I lost all of them.
And I have two quick announcements, and then we can get on to the reception. Our next program is November 12th. We're featuring Betty Caroli, historian and author of Lady Bird and Lyndon, The Hidden Story of a Marriage That Made It President. And if you would like to join our email list for program announcements and or Friends of Ford, we also have forms available for that outside of the auditorium. So, and thank you all for your wonderful questions, too. Now we invite you to meet Tom Davis and Martin Frost. Get your book signed and enjoy the reception. Thank you very much for coming.